I'm really scraping the bottom of the barrel for these jokes. I'm trying hard. I tried these out on my daughter, Elisa. She gave this one got a nod of approval just by a very narrow margin. The joke goes like this. I'm sure many of you are familiar with the...
Excuse me, can everyone be quiet, please?
I'm sure many of you are familiar with the almost mythic town of Chelm, which is renowned in Jewish metaphor as the city where, all the, let's say, less than average intelligence Jews used to live. The story is, we say this about Chelm, but it's not at all true. Chelm had an amazing yeshiva, and perhaps this was kind of a way of subverting the reputation of Chelm by speaking about it in less than complimentary terms. So at any rate, all the Chelm jokes are basically the same. They run the same trope of being, about people who make stupid decisions and so on. So the joke goes like this. One morning, there's a family in Chelm, and they are, sitting around the table having breakfast, and the father is buttering a slice of bread that his wife had baked the other day, and he's looking forward to eating it, and then something just distracts him for a minute, and he drops his bread. And, he sighs, he looks down on the ground, and he sees it landed butter side up. He's amazed. What is this? He calls his wife over, he doesn't want to touch it, he's not sure what to do, he calls his children, everyone's, completely mispala, they're all amazed, what does this mean? They start asking around, and someone says, we should go to the rabbi, we should ask the rabbi what this means. So they go to the town rabbi. The town rabbi says, are you sure? He sends over some of his gabayim to go and actually look and verify it. In fact, it did land butter side up. So the rabbi has to go and consult all of the great sforim. He goes and he pulls out the Talmuds and the Shulchan Aruch. He's looking back and forth and back and forth. Everyone's sitting, waiting already. A crowd is gathered outside the rabbi's house. They want to know how this could happen. And then finally, after the whole morning, as Stephen already knows the punchline, the rabbi says, I have the answer. You buttered the wrong side. So this joke is kind of funny because it expresses a certain level of black humor, perhaps, that, of course, it's natural would land butter side down. And in many ways, that's very expressive of the topic that we're going to be discussing today, which is the Maharam of Rotenburg. Very important rabbi on many levels. Where's our PowerPoint? It's making noises, but it's not switching. This computer, I think, came from Chelm, perhaps. Let's see, figure out what's going on. Maybe here we go. Yeah, didn't like my joke. Let me try this again. Okay, and then I'll push play. Yes, there we go. Okay. We're going to be looking at Meir ben Baruch of Rotenburg, a very important 13th century rabbi. He's significant in many different areas. We're going to focus on two of them. We're going to focus on his activity as a jurist, as a legalist, as a member of the venerated profession of Talmudists, because in many ways he really took areas that were fairly gray in Talmudic thought, in particular the role of local custom, the role of non-Jewish custom, and gave us some very definitive ideas about how to incorporate or reject those ideas in our own jurisprudence. And the kind of theoretical work that he did in halacha was of signal importance in describing the way in which Jews would exist in the diaspora for the next 700 years. In many ways, he articulated a vision of how Jews could exist as a minority with our own independent legal system, but at the same time, that legal system could interface with very, very different legal systems all over the European continent. And he became world famous, really, well, at least within the European Ashkenazi world, famous for making these very valid decisions that shaped our world to this time. The second area that I'd like to really focus on is his activity as a communal leader, because it was not just his Talmudic scholarship that came to the fore that described his activity. It was really his sense of vision and his political intuition that said a lot about how Jews could survive in very hostile environments, and he personally and heroically made decisions that were disastrous for himself in particular. He did so knowingly and consistently for years in order to protect the Jewish people from much greater harm. And so these two aspects, his work as a jurist and secondly his work as a communal leader, will be the focus of our discussion tonight. And I think we should just get started right away. This is probably one of the only roughly period pictures we have of the Maharam of Rotenburg, as he was known. Maharam is a strange kind of way of shortening his name, Meir ben Baruch of Rotenburg, and so that's how he's usually cited as the Maharam. This is one of the earliest artistic renditions of it. The author of this image probably never got to meet the Maharam in Rotenburg, but because after all we're talking the 13th century, but I've chosen some Roman Vishniac pictures that are probably roughly the same. Okay, here we go. Roman Vishniac, tremendous photographer of pre-war Europe. So he came from a very distinguished and illustrious family in Ashkenaz, came from the city of Worms. You'll recall we've spoken many times about the three cities known by the acronym Shum, Speyer, Worms, and Mainz. In the upper Rhineland, very important part of central Ashkenaz, and his father was a Rosh Yeshiva there. The yeshivas at that time were quite different from what we call the yeshiva today. They tended to be much more casual. They did not have a very fixed curriculum. They typically employed very few actual teachers. It was more like a discipleship. A group of students would be gathered around a particular individual, but nevertheless, his father was extremely significant in that regard. Maharam can count in his father's generation 12 rabbis, very significant number within one generation alone, among his uncles and cousins. And the Maharam received a tremendous amount of training at his father's knee, and then later he traveled around to the other cities in Ashkenaz and further south to Provence, where he studied under some extremely important rabbis, whose names I won't bore you with tonight. If you're very familiar with Talmudic literature, however, you would recognize his teachers as being extremely prominent. What turning point in his life occurred in 1240. When he was witness to the infamous disputation of the Talmud, which occurred in Paris. You may recall, we spoke about this a little bit last year, Nicholas Donin was an apostate, a Jewish convert to Christianity, who, as many did in the 13th century, he sought to advance his own personal cause by declaiming the evils of Judaism, and in particular the Talmud, to the Catholic Church. In the 13th century, we'll talk about the century as a whole in a few minutes, was a very important time when the church was ascendant, and the church was especially interested in, as they say in Latin, was tut sich mit der Juden, what are the Jews up to? And they were very interested for the first time, really, in the Talmud as a text, one of the basic ideas that developed, largely as a result of Nicholas Donin's activity, was the idea that the reason why the Jews stubbornly refused to convert to Christianity some 1,300 years after the life and activity of their Savior, the reason why the Jews stubbornly refused to convert was because the Talmud ruined them. That since they were studying the Talmud from a young age, it must contain all kinds of things that inoculated Jewish youth against the attractions of being part of the majority, and in fact it did contain many arguments and discussions of Christianity and of Jesus in particular. So under Nicholas Donin's pioneering work, the church decided to get involved in the Talmud, to look at what the Talmud says, and ultimately to try to destroy the Talmud with the thought that by destroying the Talmud, maybe we should pause and everybody should turn off the cell phones.
Good idea.
Did I turn mine off? Okay. So we should... So the idea was by attacking the Talmud, they thought they would uproot Judaism from the very beginning. Donin, spoke about the contents of the Talmud to the Pope, Innocent III, and so the Pope said, okay, fine, let's have a formal disputation. Let's have the Jews attempt to defend their Talmud, and they invited Rabbi Achiel of Paris, who was the former teacher of Nicholas of Donin. And the two of them sat down and they had a major public disputation in an attempt to undermine the validity of the Talmud and to make its publication and study illegal. The disputation began in the year 1239 when the Pope ordered, as kind of like a prophylactic measure, the seizure of all the Talmuds in Paris. The Pope called for the seizure of Talmuds all over Europe, but only the King Louis IX of Paris complied and actually gathered up all of these texts. And so with these texts kind of held in escrow, they invited, they coerced Rabbi Yechiel and Nicholas Donen to dispute. These pictures, by the way, are all characteristic of the period. The color was added later, but this is a traditional woodcut. You can see here's a Christian prelate pointing to the biblical text, and the Jew shown here because he's wearing this unique hat called the Judenhut. The Judenhut was a conical hat that was imposed on the Jews after the Fourth Lateran Council of 1215. We'll talk about it again in a moment, but it's very good for historians because whenever you have these kind of woodcuts and other types of art, you can always identify who is the Jew. It's also interesting to note that the Judenhut later evolved, according to many art historians, into two other kinds of hats. Originally, it was associated solely with Jews, but over the next few centuries, it was associated with witches. Of course, the witches wear the same kind of conical hat. And not so much in my generation, but certainly in my father's generation, the dunce cap. You'd have to wear that round hat and sit in the corner. It was meant to be a ridiculous-looking hat that was designed to set a Jew apart and to prevent them from assimilating into society because they were, you could see immediately that this was a Jew and not a member of the larger society.
Did the women have to wear hats?
The women did not have to wear hats, but there was something called a ruel. I'll show you a picture of a ruel later. It was a round badge. That was supposed to represent the 30 silver pieces that Judas received to betray Jesus. And Jews had to wear it either on their breast or on one of their shoulder blades. Yeah, and women were required to wear this as well. The reality of it is, though, that in many, many cases, maybe even most cases, Jews got around it by bribing local officials. You know, you could negotiate, and, you know, people ignored it, especially when you're talking about, you know, small villages. Let's forget about London and Paris, but small villages where there are maybe 5,000, maybe 10,000 people, everybody knows who's a Jew. So you're not trying to, not fooling anybody with the ruel or with the hat and things like that. So it was easier simply just to pay a bribe and get around it. At any rate, the charges against the Talmud were, there are 35 separate accusations in this particular dispute. One was that the Talmud was irreligious, meaning that the Bible was the basis of Judaism, just as it is for Christianity, and the Talmud sought to replace it. You didn't need the Bible, you could go straight to the Talmud. So the charge was that the Jews would be more religious if only they got rid of the Talmud. Secondly, it was idolatrous, primarily because the Talmud has a lot of anthropomorphisms, referring to God in human terms, like waking up in the middle of the night and screaming like a lion, God's hand, God's anger, God's jealousy, all kinds of things like this, which also exist in the Bible, but the charge was that the Talmud was idolatrous for that reason. The Talmud was obscene, because the Talmud is definitely, for those of you who had had the opportunity to study the Talmud, there is no subject which is not part of the Talmud. You know, sex, drugs, rock and roll, everything is in the Talmud. Nothing is, you know, forbidden for discussion. And so it was easy to find all kinds of discussions there which would be considered obscene to the medieval mind. And even, one could say, it might even be obscene to many 20th century readers as well. 21st, I don't know. We have a pretty liberal century. Finally, it was blasphemous, filled with lots of anti-Christian sentiments. And this was actually true. There were a lot of, I wouldn't say a lot. I mean, the Talmud is concerned with all kinds of things, you know, the whole gamut of human existence, from ritual law to civil law, criminal law, philosophy, ethics, biographies, recipes, you know, remedies, you name it. There are all kinds of things in the Talmud. And every now and then, you know, if you're talking about religion or about other religions, some rabbi will make some kind of demeaning remark about, for example, Jesus' parentage and things like that, because the Jews, the rabbis of the Talmud didn't buy the Immaculate Conception and things like this, so therefore there were all kinds of snide remarks here and there. And so it was not hard to find these things, and Nicholas Adonin, of course, knew where to look for them. And so these 35 charges were brought before Rabbi Yechiel of Paris. The Maharam of Rotenburg was there as a young man when this disputation occurred. Ultimately, as you would expect, Rabbi Yechiel did not win the dispute. It was preordained that he could not win in this argument. And therefore, once these charges were considered to be true, then the King of France ordered all of the Talmud manuscripts to be gathered up, the ones that were kept in escrow, and they were all publicly burned in the year 1242. The records that we have of that time, both Jewish and Christian, describe the incident, and some 24 carriage loads, which represented 10,000 handwritten manuscripts, absolutely incalculable value, were burned publicly in Paris. The Maharam, again, in his youth, he composed a kina, which means it's a liturgical poem of sadness, an elegy, which is actually part of the Tisha B'Av liturgy to this day, based on this particular burning of the Talmud in Paris. And that was kind of a formative turning point in his life. He's going to return to Rothenburg now, where he will begin his career as a Talmudist. Let's kind of take you up to his youth and the things that influenced his thought. What I'd like to do is kind of step back now and look a little bit at the 13th century in general and what's important for Jews, but let me pause and take some questions first. Yes?
What is that?
This is, I'm sorry, it's a detail. Elisa, do you want to turn off the lights for a second? We get them. The problem with this kind of presentation is if I leave it bright, then you can see me and everyone stays awake. If I make it dark, then you see the images a little better, but this is a detail of an artistic description of the burning of the Talmud. This is actually not the burning from 1242. This is a burning from the 15th century, if I remember correctly, in Germany, but you get the same idea. The Talmud was burned several times in Europe. Okay.
Thank you.
So do you like the lights better or the no lights?
No.
Yes,
no
Stephen?
Lights.
Okay, let's go with lights.
You can't see anything.
I just realized I had not figured that out moments before I started today's lecture. And I was thinking, I hope no one will ask me how they got that. It's as if they removed the name. His name was Meir, or was Baruch Ben Meir. So it was Baruch Ben Meir. Then where's the B?
It was
Meir Ben Baruch. Good. So where's... So I think it's Maharam, would be Moreno Harav Meir. Oh, there, now I sound intelligent, right? Moreno, art teacher, Harav, the rabbi, and Harav in this 13th century was a term that was reserved for Roshe Yeshiva. So our teacher, the head of the yeshiva, Meir, from Rothenburg. Put me on the spot. Yeah, I did. Duck the bullet. Okay. Yes.
When was the burning? What year was it?
1242.
So it's like right around Rambam's Mishneh Torah burning?
Ah, excellent observation, Mr. Rodriguez. Mm-hmm. It was burned 10 years, the Talmud was burned 10 years to the day after the, not to the day, to the year, after Maimonides' burning, manuscripts were also burned in the same spot in Paris. Mm-hmm. When the Dominicans got the taste of how fun it was to burn Jewish manuscripts, it was hard to...
Wasn't that at the urging of Jews to burn the Mishneh Torah?
Right.
And then it kind of got them started, and it got the Talmud burned too.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
The courtyard of the Louvre.
Yes, exactly. I mean, it's a very sad story that when we start burning our own books, then other people will, continue the process for us. Okay. I thought I was going to talk about something else first, but I'll talk about this first. I think I have one more slide before we get to the 13th century. No, I didn't. Okay, I have two more slides. Let's talk about two more slides about his life, then I want to go 13th century. So his rise to fame was he went back to Rothenburg, and he ended up establishing this yeshiva. It attracted students from all over Europe, as far away as Spain. And this is really quite an impressive thing in the 13th century. This was the era of the Tosafos, which is the grandchildren of Rashi and many, many other dozens of scholars who all contributed analytical comments to the Talmud, which were later recorded and published alongside the Talmud. His home was the yeshiva itself. It was provided by the community. It was quite large. We know it had 21 rooms, including a Beit Midrash, a study hall, and even a kind of primitive dormitory for his students so that traveling students could, in fact, live there. We also know, however, that Maharam largely followed Maimonides' dicta in that he would not accept a fee for his learning. He didn't teach for money. It was kind of like, you know, one of the greatest yeshivas in the world today is the Meir, which is over 180 years old, and it still does not charge tuition. It's an amazing thought when you think of an elite institution not charging tuition. Of course, the money has to come from somewhere, but it does not come from the students who, at that stage in their life, are least likely to be able to pay for it. He was a businessman and quite successful, and he lived entirely off the proceeds of his businesses. But he was recognized primarily as the superior posek of his generation, meaning a posek is someone who is a decisor in Jewish law, from the word pasak, which means to cut. You know, when you have a complicated situation and someone cuts it and says, this is exactly what we're going to do and no more. He was a posek that was renowned as the Gadol Hador, the great one of the generation, in a generation where there were many great rabbis. Now, his responsa, we have over 1,000 of them today. Responsa, you recall, we've spoken about this term in the past, the way Jewish law worked then is, that, and it was still today as well, is that people would have a specific question, and they would go to their local rabbi, saying, Rabbi, Rabbi, you know, I dropped the bread, and it landed butter side up, what does it mean? And if the local rabbi is stumped, then he will pass that question on to a still greater rabbi. So the Maharam was kind of where all of the questions stopped. The greatest questions went to him, and he answered them. So we have those, the records of his answers, which constitute precedents and are used later, cited later in Jewish law. We have over 1,000 of them, and we really get a sense of his personality from the extent of his writings. For example, he was not kind of like cold and distant. He was really quite deeply involved in the problems, and you often hear his emotion coming through in his decisions. He is often outraged when he hears of very heinous crimes, and you can read in the text his anger that he feels that such a crime had been committed. And he's also easily irritated with frivolous lawsuits, especially if something had been asked and answered in the past. And nevertheless, this case was brought to him and forced him to convene his Beit Din. He expressed impatience quite readily in his writings. He also, you know, showed a lot of compassion in his writings, including one really terrible responsa where a heartbroken man had killed his entire family, fearing that they were going to be captured by Christian mobs and potentially converted to Christianity or tortured or killed. And he felt that it would be better to kill his own family rather than allow them to be captured. This may be indicative of a man with a severe mental illness, or if his assessment of the situation was correct, perhaps he was thinking to the Crusades, which were really only a century before, where this was a common occurrence among Ashkenazi Jews, where they literally killed, you know, entire congregations would draw lots and would kill each other rather than be handed over to the Christian Crusaders. And so in such a case, this particular man, who was completely heartbroken, he begged to, you know, to be forgiven and to be somehow allowed to, you know, incorporate himself back into the community, which wanted to ostracize him. And the Maharam ruled that, in fact, he should be accepted as a Jew in good standing in the community. He argued that he committed this crime because he felt it was somehow justified, and his heartbreak at losing his family was sufficient punishment for him under these circumstances. And he justified that decision by saying that earlier rabbis, including Rashi, who we've spoken about before, forgave those Jews who did similar things in the hands of the Crusaders. How much more so should they, in the 13th century, extend the same consideration? But you get a sense also of the nature of life, the very precarious nature of life in the 13th century from these kinds of responsa. Perhaps more significantly, though, for his role as a jurist, was a pretty consistent theme that ran through most of his responsa, indicating respect for local custom. Many questions came to him saying, wait a minute, it says in the Talmud this, but we forever have been doing something different. Or, it says in the Talmud this, But, you know, if we actually keep what it says in the Talmud, it will be very difficult for us to make a living. We will find that we are at variance with local customs with regards things like, well, just off the top of my head, the concept of the just price, the idea that how much markup are you allowed to put on retail goods. So without getting into the complexities of it, the Talmud basically says you are only really allowed to mark things up 1/6 of their original value. So if something, I'm not going to try and calculate it, 1/6 markup, 15%, thank you. So that's a pretty low markup. I imagine some industries like groceries or something have a low markup like that, but most industries have more like a 50 to 100% markup. And in many places, the Jews were saying, you know, we just can't manage with this sort of Talmudic dictum, and nobody else is doing it. So we're simply going to become, you know, impoverished if we obey it. The Maharam very often in these kinds of situations, not necessarily the just price, but he argued that Jews could follow prevailing economic practices, even if in some ways they were not perfectly in line with what the Talmud was dictating. And finally, very importantly, he argued that communal decisions must be made democratically. This was a theme that pervaded most of his work. He was not a rabbinocrat, if that's a real word, someone like believing that the rabbi should be in charge, a theocrat. He believed that the community should have the right to essentially determine their own destiny. Obviously, they're not allowed to vote to, you know, obviate a mitzvah in the Torah. They're not allowed to vote to say something which is forbidden is now permitted or vice versa. But in the area of how they manage their affairs, the democratic consensus should be adhered to. Very, very significant thing in Talmudic law, because much of the Talmud was written already in exile and Jews did not have necessarily that kind of control over their lives. He was really pioneering these essential questions about how Jews would govern their own lives. It's not completely democratic. For example, one very important element of society were completely disenfranchised, and those were
the women,
absolutely. So it's not really democratic. Thank you, Judith. Women did not have a vote. Another very significant element of the community was disenfranchised. Besides women,
children.
Okay, I don't count children. Besides Eliza, she's wonderful, but she's already after bas mitzvah. The propertyless, right? You had to have a certain amount of wealth to have a say. And the more wealth, the more of a say. So it was not democratic in a, you know, perfect sense, but yeah, you know, if you had wealth and you were male, then you had a say. Judith.
I was just wondering, is that, it's not property, real estate?
No, it's wealth.
Wealth,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, assets.
Yeah.
A cow, right? A cow, wow, he gets the vote.
A cow is good.
All right. So this was really important because he really set the rules for how Jewish communities would govern themselves. And there's some evidence to indicate that a lot of his thinking bled over into the Christian world, that Christian municipalities were also developing at this time, and they looked to the Jews who were highly urbanized for models of their own leadership structures. And so the Maharam may have had a signal impact on all of Europe, not just the Jewish minority per se. So now, let's finally go to the 13th century, because we have to speak a little bit broader here. 13th century was an extremely important time. Oh, by the way, here's a couple of pictures of Jews wearing the ruel. See here, these are obviously 17th century renditions. They're quite a bit later, but it shows you how long these things lasted, right? The ruel here on both the male and the female. I do not know why she's holding a goose, but this is, I guess, women walk. It was a fashion accessory, I guess. 13th century was an extremely. I'm sorry?
She's taking it to the shofet.
She's taking it to the shofet. Yeah, all right. Okay. So, the 13th century was an extremely important time when the church and the secular powers, the temporal powers, really began to duke it out and to decide who is really going to be in charge of Europe. Kings, nobles, they traditionally had held power. Don't forget that some of these areas were not Christian for that long. You know, maybe a few hundred years they had earlier, they had adopted Christianity. Many of these regions adopted forms of Christianity which were later declared heretical, and so then they had to re-Christianize as Catholics. So it was still a very evolving area for the church as a whole. And as the church was ascendant in the 13th century, the church began to assert its authority and say that ideally, all secular rulers should be subjugated to the church. The temporal authorities, the kings and so on, you know, they rebelled at this notion, and the 13th century was kind of a proving ground when the church was winning for some time. Later on, of course, the secular powers would begin to get the upper hand, and ultimately you would have the Reformation, which would really take down the church, but at this time the church was beginning to wax in its authority. When the church had authority, they had doctrinal concerns about the Jews. What do you do with the Jews in Europe? On a kind of a theoretical level, the church had a difficult way of trying to accommodate the reality of Jews in Europe. They had this doctrine that was first articulated by St. Augustine called the Doctrine of Witness, later confirmed by Pope Gregory the Great in the 7th century, that said that basically you can't kill all the Jews. You may want to, but you can't kill all the Jews. You have to let them live. Why? Because when Jesus comes back for the second time, the second coming, then Jews will be a witness to his divinity. Because they, as a people, were originally there, then they are the only people who can really validate that he is in fact the Messiah. It's kind of a strange argument. It's sort of like, you know, if you imagine that there's this chulent recipe that has been in the family for generations, and everyone's been making chulent exactly the same way, and then suddenly along comes, you know, someone, let's say her name is Shana, she goes to college, she comes back for Pesach, and she tells her family, I had this fantastic recipe where you put peanut butter in the chulent. And they're saying, peanut butter? What? That's ridiculous. But she makes the peanut butter chulent, they taste it, they say it's okay, but it's not as good as Bubby's chulent. And she gets upset about this, and this fight ensues. There is a point to this story, don't worry. And the fight gets worse and worse, and for generations and generations, Sally's daughters and their daughters are always making the chulent with peanut butter, but they can't get any of the rest of the family to admit that the peanut butter chulent is better. The only time they'll ever win and feel really secure about themselves is when one of the members of the traditional chulent family tastes the peanut butter chulent and says, Taka, this is better, then they'll be proven right. So this is exactly, I'm sure the metaphor is perfectly clear, this is why the Jews had to be maintained alive, because they had to be present for when Jesus came back and said that it's better with the peanut butter. Right? That's the whole point of it. They could be persecuted, however. The Jews were not supposed to like kind of stand out as being prosperous and successful and happy, because that would also undermine the whole idea of the doctrine of witness, which part of which implied that Jews had to live in a degraded state until the second coming. So the church had to kind of keep them down in that difficult place where they're not succeeding, they're not flourishing, but they're still present and allowed to be present. And in fact, they were occasionally useful for some things. Like, for example, it was at this time when you have the big transubstantiation controversy, where the church, the Catholic Church, is trying to advance this notion that many peasants were very skeptical of, that the wafer actually, not symbolically, but actually became the body of Jesus. This is something that many Christians of the 13th century had a very difficult time accepting. And one of the best ways they had to prove it, the church to prove this, is they said, well, if you don't believe us, look, the Jews themselves want to capture the host, that's what they called the wafer, and desecrate it. If it wasn't holy, why would the Jews bother trying to do this horrible thing to the host? And of course, Jews just want to stay away from the wafers, they don't want to get involved. We'll talk about it more next week when we look at varieties of anti-Semitism in the Middle Ages. But at any rate, this is the kind of pressure that the church exerted upon the Jews. On the other hand, when the state had its way. They had economic concerns. They wanted the Jews to be a source of income for the king in particular, and they wanted the church to keep their hands off the Jews, let the Jews become as prosperous as possible, because the more they prosper, the more they can be taxed. And so the king was often at odds with the pope, trying to say, please leave my Jews alone. They're doing a great job with all their economic activities. Let them bring in the gold. I will take my share and we'll be fine. Shalom al Yisrael, so to speak. But they, so the church and the king often had a lot of conflicting opinions as to what to do with the Jews. It's very important to understand that one of the most fundamental elements of the medieval period, which separates that period from the modern period that we live in, is this notion of a corporate society, where, unlike today, where we form voluntary groups, you know, we may choose to belong to a synagogue or a church or the JCC or whatever, but fundamentally, the modern citizen-based governments that we have today, all the way from the French Revolution onward, they deal with each of us as citizens. We have a social security number, all of our data is recorded associated with that number, and you know, the president himself could go to his desktop computer and could right there on the spot look up everything about me, because as it were, we deal directly with the government. We may have some levels of representative government, but ultimately we all have to be treated as individuals. This was not true of the medieval period. In the medieval period, it was feudal in nature, which meant that you belonged to a particular group in society, which was a socio-economic and perhaps religious group, and you couldn't get out of that group. It was as difficult to cross boundaries as you might think, and you know, be in 19th century India with the caste system. If you were a peasant, you were required to do peasant duties. You were required to remain attached to the land. You could not marry without the Lord's permission. You could not move. You could not decide you wanted to be a ballet artist or a shoemaker. You were a peasant and you had to farm. And there were several groups like this in medieval society that were quite hierarchical in nature. And the Jews were similarly within their own little bubble. The Jews constituted a group that were unlike all of the others, and they had to submit to some authority in this pyramid-like society. The problem was, where exactly do you put the Jews? We were not farmers. We were overwhelmingly involved in commerce, especially small-scale commerce. And at the same time, we were not burghers, meaning we were not officially recognized merchants in the villages. We were often not allowed into the artisans' guilds. We certainly weren't allowed into the nobility. The only group that we were really close to in many ways, and kind of like comparing the way we lived, was the clergy. The villages were filled with Jews and priests, and it was a strange kind of, you know, neighborly relationship, because the vast majority of people lived in the farms, and they came into the villages twice a week to conduct their business. And the Jews had this weird spot. Who do they report to? And when they generate wealth, who gets a share of that wealth? This was a major debate that was fought in the 13th century, and the Maharam was right at the center of it. One last detail about the corporate nature of society. So if we all lived in our own little bubbles, and there was a Jewish bubble, the Jews had a tremendous system of self-government, which was really inherited from Babylonian times and reached its peak when it got to the 16th century in Poland in particular. But this structure, known as the kehillah structure, the word kehillah is derived from the Hebrew root kahal, which means to congregate. It's basically the model that we use for most modern synagogues today as well. It's a very, very useful model, and it provided the Jews with the means to create a social safety net that was cradle to grave and allowed the Jews to care for themselves as a community, a very self-reliant structure and so on. Here's how it worked. And you have to realize that in the Middle Ages, there was no social services. There were no public hospitals. There were no public orphanages. You know, if you didn't work, you didn't eat. It was basically very savage. You could throw yourself on the mercy of the church, perhaps, and you could become a beggar or a highwayman. But there was no system to help people who are disadvantaged. really, except in the Jewish world with the Kehillah structure. And it looked like this. At the top of the Kehillah was a group called the Tuvei Ha'ir, which means the good people of the city. They're roughly equivalent to what most synagogues would call their board of directors. Membership in the Tuvei Ha'ir was exclusively male and exclusively, the wealthy. It was a privilege to belong to the Tuvei Ha'ir, which was usually 5 to 7 members on the Tuvei Ha'ir, and membership in this group carried a kind of a price tag. Since you were appointed as a communal leader, you were expected to also help defray the costs of those less advantaged. So you had to give up parnasa, but you got instead kavod. You had to give up wealth, but instead you got, honor for it. The Tuvei Ha'ir would appoint on a regular basis two major institutions. They would appoint a parnas. The word is probably related to the English word president. It means the provider, like Yosef Parnas, right? And this, he would be, again, it's always he would be in charge of the executive wing, and he would run the community. He would make sure that what needed to be done was in fact done, including the collection of mandatory taxes, the assessment of taxes from the Jews, the collection and then distribution of those taxes. In order to do that, he had a group of individuals called gabayim, gabais. The word gabayim literally means collectors or enforcers. And these were essentially, I think policemen is too strong a term, but these were the court-appointed authorities who made sure that you paid the taxes that you were assessed. You made sure that if you divorced your wife, you gave her the get. That all these things were done by the gabayim. The gabayim also would report to the Beit Din, or the Jewish court, the judiciary. And whenever there was these two groups kind of balanced each other out to a certain degree, because if the parnas overstepped his authority, then the Beit Din was able to, address it and indicate that it was not being done in accordance with Jewish law. However, the Beit Din was also an appointed position and paid for by the funds from the Tuvei Ha'ir. So occasionally, the Beit Din would be thrown out and the head of the Beit Din would be replaced. So if you think this is a little bit like a synagogue arrangement where you have, this is the board of directors, this would be the president of the shul, this is the rabbi of the shul. The rabbi has a tremendous amount of authority, but if the rabbi oversteps that authority, then he may get replaced. So to the president, certainly he has a time limit, he could be replaced as well. It's the same structure. The gabayim in a shul, of course, they have really just a shadow of the form of power they used to have in the community. They just decide, who gets the first aliyah, the second aliyah, things like who davens from the amud. It's not nearly as powerful a position as it used to be, but that's essentially where they came from. Now, the real work of the community was conducted down here by a whole series of groups, called chevras, or associations. If this was a business chart, we called them committees. And unlike the rest of the positions, these were often, if not predominantly, staffed by women. So the actual work of the community was often done by the women who were leading the chevra, for example, to collect tomchei Shabbos, support for people who had difficulty making Shabbos properly, or linas tzedek, making sure that travelers had a place to sleep when they came into town, or the chevra
kedisha.
Well, the chevra kedisha, that's the most important of them. In fact, in many ways, the chevra kedisha, even though it's here, it really had more power than anybody. The chevra kedisha is the burial society, and one of the most feared punishments that the Tuvei Ha'ir could mete out to a person is to say, if you don't pay the taxes we've assessed, then the Chevra Kedisha will not bury you. And that was a terrifying thing, to be thought that your body would just be tossed in the communal pits that, the local cities used. That was terrifying. So the Chevra Kedisha was reserved only for the most really well-respected and senior members of the committee. Beautiful about Jewish ethics that the people who deal with the dead are considered the most respected of all. But that's basically how the Jews organized themselves within the corporate structure, and it was a structure that was vastly superior to anything that the peasants had, or the burghers, or even the artisans with their guilds. They didn't have anything nearly as extensive or as pervasive as this way of taking care of themselves.
These were paid positions, or part-time? Or?
Well, typically the chevras were not paid. You know, you were, it's a volunteer position, right? Women's, a lot of volunteer work. No, the Jewish community is built on volunteer work. One of the interesting analyses that's coming out of the impact of feminism on the Jewish world is that as women go into careers, all of a sudden there's a vacuum with all these crucial volunteer positions. You know, I mean, my mother, she should live and be well. She also works in the store and things like that, but she was always with Rebecca and with Hadassahs and with all kinds of things like that. How many women of my generation or my daughter's generation will do that? I don't know. And what does that mean for those organizations? It's a really rapid change that's happening in 50 years that we haven't had beforehand. So these were typically unpaid positions. Yes?
Did the Kehillah start in Germany?
The Kehillah actually goes all the way back to Babylon. It's a very old system, but it was refined over centuries of the diaspora. It really existed right up until the 19th century as a viable municipal organization. It was finally destroyed in 1844 by Tsar Nicholas I. But the idea of it was you know, maintained at least on a voluntaristic basis with synagogues. The thing that really makes it work, though, is not really placed on this chart, and that is there's no exit. You can't leave. The only way out of the Kehillah is to convert to Christianity. And so, you know, if you didn't like your parnas and you didn't like the taxes you were assessed, well, you could go to the Beit Din and complain there and maybe you'd get some traction, or you just have to eat it. You just have to do it.
You couldn't go to a different community?
You could go to a different community, but your transgressions in one would follow you to the next one. Especially when you have the development of something called the Vaad Arba Aratzot, the Council of Lands, where all of the Kehillah, an amazing thing, they developed this network that extended from the Baltic Sea to the Black Sea, where, you know, you simply were part of a huge, literally a Jewish state within a state. So it was, what made it work was the coercive power that, you know, coercion on the one hand, you know, I think it irks us as modernists and as Americans, but on the other hand, it's great for maintaining a minority in the diaspora. It means sure that everybody is marching more or less in lockstep. It's only when the possibility of a secular Jewish identity emerges in the 18th century that the Kehillah structure really loses its power. Okay, well, lots to say. Let's go a little further. Okay, so let's go back to the Maharam. The most tragic part of his life, the last few years of his life, came when the German Emperor Rudolf I, in an attempt to assert the power of the king over the power of the church that we discussed earlier, he made a decree that Jews would formerly be placed in the feudal structure as so-called servi camerae, which means servants of the royal chamber. In other words, if you saw that triangular diagram I showed you earlier where you have peasants on the bottom and then knights and nobility and so on, where do you put the Jews? Are they below the nobility but above the knights? Are they below? Where do you put them? So he wanted to say, from now on, the Jews report directly and exclusively to the king. They do not distribute, as they had in many communities, their taxes to the local nobility. So let's say you lived, I don't know, in the Bavarian region, and you were a Jew, and you were a money lender, a typical profession for Jews back then, and you made X amount of I don't know, crowns. You would have to pay, let's say, 10% of those crowns a year to the local duke, and your taxes would go to the official who was more or less in charge of your town. Rudolf I said, no, this has to stop. From now on, the Jews belong to me. They are the king's Jews, and all taxes that are accrued from their activity come directly to the king. So what this meant, it was kind of a double-edged sword. On the one hand, and actually, ultimately, this would be the reality over the next 100 years in Europe, the reality is it meant that the Jews could claim the protection of the crown itself. If they were threatened, you know, they could say, hey, we report directly to the king. You mess with us, and you're ultimately messing with the king. And that was a bit of a protection. But on the other hand, it essentially reduced their function to those of slaves. It says something about their personal status in the medieval feudal environment. And the Maharam felt that this was very, very dangerous for the Jews. And so as a result, in 1286, the Maharam led a massive exodus of Jews from Germany. They said, we can't live here anymore. If the king is really going to do this to us, then we're going to move, let's say, to France. It's not so far away. And so he gathered up all of his followers, or a large number of his followers, and they simply left Germany. They made it to Lombardy, and there he was recognized by a Jewish convert to Christianity, and was betrayed to the local authorities, and he was arrested. He was arrested on the grounds of offending the king, and of attempting to avoid taxes and so on. This is from the grave of Rudolf of Frisian. So he was placed in prison, and he lived there for 7 years until his death. He was never released after that moment. It was not the worst type of prison experience because he was allowed access to his books and a considerable number of visitors, but nevertheless, his freedom of movement was curtailed and in fact ended. Now, the strange thing is that Rudolf was willing to release him upon the payment of a tax of 23,000 pounds of silver, a very large amount of money. As you can imagine, even in contemporary dollars, that would be a phenomenal sum. And that sum was available to the Jewish community, and they were willing to pay it. But the Maharam refused to allow the Jews to buy him out of jail. He refused to allow them to give the money to the king. He said, it would be more important that I stay in jail than you give up all of that money. So what was his reasoning? Why didn't he want to release himself? Basically,
set of precedent.
Yes, two major issues. The first issue was that he would only allow them to pay it if it was explicitly called a ransom, meaning that he was kidnapped and they ransomed him. That would make the king look pretty bad. He was a kidnapper. But he refused to allow it to be portrayed in any way as a tax. Because if it was a case where, you know, the king argued that Jews were engaging in tax evasion, that he had made this rule that they had to pay the taxes, and they refused to pay it, and now they pay it up, and he says, fine, of course I'm going to release your leader, this great rabbi, because you paid the taxes that you owe me. But that would also mean that the Jews acquiesced to becoming servi camerae. And they would be, from then on, slaves directly to the king. And the Maharam did not want to give the notion that, in fact, that would be legitimate. And so he'd rather stay in jail than have them pay up. The other major issue is the precedent of, you know, what does it mean if you can kidnap a rabbi and get paid 23,000 pounds in silver? That would place the entire European continent's worth of rabbis at grave risk. And so he didn't want to be released on such a high ransom because he didn't want to, you know, escalate the cost of kidnapping. You know, here in our community, we have so many Jews from Latin America. And, you know, I know myself personally people who have been kidnapped when they were living in Latin America. And I even a friend whose brother-in-law was killed when he was kidnapped, even after they paid the ransom. And they tell me that one of the worst things that can happen to a person is if the kidnappers learn that you hold kidnapping insurance. Because as soon as they know that you have insurance, then you become more of a target for kidnapping because they know the money is going to be available for sure. So the Maharam refused to allow them to pay such a large amount because he felt that this would just, you know, be more of an incentive for a kidnapping in the future. He died in 1293, and the king continued to hold his body ransom. And it was only in 1307 when a very wealthy Jew named Alexander Wimpfen ultimately was able to negotiate the release of the body. It also involved the payment of money as well. And when the Maharam was finally interred in the barrack in the graveyard in Worms, you can see his picture is over here. This is his grave. And after the rescue of his body died, he was buried immediately next to him in the cemetery. You can see here that the graves are filled with stones. With Jewish custom to leave a stone when you visit a grave. And the pictures that I've seen look kind of interesting. Seems there's a lot of scraps of paper written here.
Kvitzel.
Yeah, maybe it's a custom there to write a little kvitzel, a little prayer, and leave it at the grave, which of course is a practice among many Jews today, not too common in America. So if we wrap up by analyzing the legacy of this unique figure. Ah, Ms. Abramson. The man who paid for the release of his body. In many cemeteries, they have a custom of not burying people next to their spouses. It's a way of keeping the peace. Sorry, no, it is. You do see that every now and then. It's not really a custom in America, but you often see it where husbands and wives.
Did he have a spouse? Is he married?
Could lead to mixed dancing, right? Yeah. Okay. I don't know too much about his family, I'm afraid. So the legacy of the Maharam. You know, he's a major figure in the establishment of Ashkenazic practice. Many of the customs we have today, like for example, off the top of my head, do we consider the 2 days of Rosh Hashanah two separate days, two separate holidays, or one long day? So he ruled, well, we consider it one long day, but nevertheless, we say the Shehecheyanu Bracha on the second night, and we also, wear a new article of clothing or have a fruit on the table, something like that, to mark it. Thousands and thousands of Jewish ritual practices come from the decisions of the Maharam. Secondly, perhaps more significantly than ritual practice, is his jurisprudence and specific focus on how to run a community. How do you make decisions? Do you have an autocratic leader? Do you put a rabbi in charge? Who's in charge? And he argued for the practice of democracy, albeit a limited democracy, but nevertheless the idea that there should be a consensus in the communities. That was extremely important. He temporarily, ultimately he would fail in this regard, but he temporarily held off the imposition of the Servi Camerae status to Jews in Europe. The economic forces were so great, however, that he simply could not hold it off after he passed away. And but nevertheless, his willingness to uproot from Germany really sent a strong signal to all the Jews of Ashkenaz, and one can credit the beginning of the ultimately huge exodus of Jews to Poland and Lithuania to the position of the Maharam in the 13th century. So with that, I'm going to conclude. I thank you very much for your attention and your indulgence. We have three more weeks left in this series for the fall. We'll meet, God willing, on the 26th, January 2nd and January 9th. And then we're going to have a very short break because it's intercession. We follow the Torah College calendar where there are a lot of really exciting Shabbatonim planned at Young Israel. You're welcome to enjoy the great speakers. And God willing, after those 3 weeks are over and then the break is up, we'll begin again with lectures in February. Okay. Thank you again.